paschatadishutarine. Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadha Shri Vashadi Gaur Bhaktavinda Jaya Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadha Shri Vashadi Gaur Bhaktavinda
Jaya Shri
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare.
Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna.
Bhagavataya Krishna Prishthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Niti Namane Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatta Dakshatarine Srila Prabhupada Ki Sorry, just make this shorter. Become top heavy. So I'm very happy to be here, and I'm very happy to see that this very important course is being so systematically conducted by Madhupati Prabhu. And as Madhupati Prabhu briefly described the importance of this course, because everything needs training. For everything we need a systematic way to understand. Like we have practicing Krishna consciousness, what it means, how it should be conducted, how we should practice it. There's a need for gradual and systematic training. In the initial stage, Prabhupada was just busy establishing ISKCON. So Prabhupada at that time just got everyone to become engaged in just serve, spread the movement, distribute books, make devotees. And those days there was no time for training actually. Like devotees, just few months in the movement, Prabhupada sent them to different corners of the world. And of course, Prabhupada was training in his own way. Prabhupada made this arrangement. Prabhupada's training system was morning program, temple program, Bhagavad class, Bhagavad Gita classes, and Prabhupada himself was writing books. And that was Prabhupada's way of training the devotees. Through his books he was training the devotees. And devotees were also very enthusiastic to read books. I remember when I joined, when a new volume came out, like we went crazy. Like one volume came and the 25 of us just wanted to read it at the same time. So what we used to do is just sit together and read. We used to go in circle, one after another person. We used to sit in the afternoons when, after prashad, when you're relatively free. We used to sit down and in a group and read the books. Even more exciting was the way they did it in Russia. You know, in Russia, they just somehow smuggled in the Bhagavad Gita. One copy. They used to separate, they split the Bhagavad Gita into 18 chapters. And that is, they used to circulate that. One book used to become 18 books. And 18 people at the same time could read. Like, that is how the excitement was those days, the spirit was those days. And as I said, like there was a natural inclination for reading, and those days everyone was a temple devotee. Really, you'll be shocked to hear, if anyone lived outside, that means those who did not live in a temple, according to our understanding, they all were karmis. Only the temple devotees were devotees. If one didn't live in a temple, so this is how things were those days. The spirit was very high, and that spirit was generated by Srila Prabhupada. And devotees, you have seen what the devotees have done. The young devotees, 20, 21 year old boys and girls, they left their homes, became full-time devotees, and soon they left even the temples, and went to some remote corners of the world. They went, young boys and girls went to the remote corners of the world and started a temple. Like sometimes one person single-handedly went to some remote island, like Mauritius, like Fiji. One devotee, Upendra Prabhu, he just went there. He was in Australia, and from Fiji, from Australia, Fiji is not that far. And there was a large Indian community in Fiji. So he thought, why not go there and start? And another example is an 18-year-old boy. He was there in Mayapur, and he saw different big devotees now. By the time they were all established, GBCs and sannyasis. And he was just a 17-18-year-old boy. And he was thinking, what can I do for Srila Prabhupada? He was thinking that where can I go to spread Krishna consciousness? And he was looking at the map. And he saw practically the whole world has been taken over. The only place that was left was Africa. And so he decided to go to South Africa. And he went and told Srila Prabhupada that he wanted to go and start a center in South Africa. Prabhupada was impressed with his spirit, so Prabhupada then sent a sannyasi with him. Like it's not a brahmachari going with a sannyasi, a sannyasi going with a brahmachari to start the movement. That was the spirit. And that's how the movement started in South Africa. A very difficult situation, very difficult place, because South Africa was apartheid at that time. They didn't allow the mixing of different types of different classes of people, like whites, blacks, browns, yellow. They had all separate ideas. Whites lived in one area, blacks lived in one area, Indians lived in one area, Chinese lived in another area. And they didn't allow. It was a crime to mix, intermingle. And here an American young boy goes and starts, and he was eventually arrested by the police, and his father had to fly all the way from America to free him. So this is how things were at that time, at the beginning, at the pioneering stage. And then we saw gradually things changed considerably. Like those days everybody was in a temple and hardly anyone outside. Even the householders lived in the temple. But now the situation kind of reversed. Nobody in the temple, everyone is outside. And everyone is working. Most of you are working and you're in a household situation. So ISKCON has embarked on a different phase, and it's natural. Like ISKCON in the initial stage, pioneering stage, ISKCON was in a certain way, and then ISKCON embarked in another stage now gradually. And that's how things are happening. Another change that took place During Prabhupada, when Prabhupada was here, Prabhupada was the guru, Prabhupada was the leader, Prabhupada was the everything in this country. And everyone was just assisting Prabhupada, serving Prabhupada. GBCs, sannyasis, they all were just Prabhupada's order carrier. But then we embarked on a stage when Prabhupada left, and different devotees had to assume the role of being a spiritual master. And they did not really know how to conduct themselves as a spiritual master, most of them. And they saw Prabhupada was the spiritual master in this school. So when they became spiritual masters, they started to behave or started to act like Srila Prabhupada did. They thought that now we have become the gurus. And that created another problem. As a result of that, Prabhupada's position was eclipsed. And we saw big damage was done. And the worst thing was that those were the most prominent devotees of ISKCON. And most of them actually lost their spiritual life. Because they did not act properly, they lost their spiritual life. Eventually they left ISKCON. Most of them. And then another phase came when there was a phase of reform movement. Prabhupada left in 1977, and by 1986, ISKCON was facing a very, very critical phase. It was a time when 11 out of 6 gurus had fallen down. And not only those senior leaders who had been personally trained by Srila Prabhupada, they left. A good number of their disciples and followers also left. Already prior to that, many of Prabhupada's disciples also left, being disgruntled in various ways. So then, after that, other individuals assumed the role of being gurus, and although things have rectified to a great extent, but it was not perfectly. It was not the perfect situation still. And ISKCON is going through some organic evolution, some natural evolution. And the positive thing is that the saving grace is that ISKCON is still together. 38 years after Srila Prabhupada's disappearance, ISKCON is still together and ISKCON is still going strong. Another phase that ISKCON went through, in the early stage, it was mostly Americans and Europeans who joined the movement. Most of the devotees were European, American. Prabhupada started the movement here in America, so youth of America became attracted to Srila Prabhupada and they became affected by Srila Prabhupada's teachings. And those days, Indians were a rare commodity. Prabhupada himself lamented at times that everyone is coming but the Indians are not coming. But now it's all Indians practically, and very few Westerners. So this is another phase that ISKCON is going through. But it's an international society. The I of ISKCON stands for international, not Indian. So this international society means there has to be the international involvement. Everyone. Prabhupada's idea was to involve everybody. But what to do? It's another phase. There was a time when it was all whites and now there is no white. So it's a phase. Sometimes devotees say, all the temples are filled with Indians. But one of my godbrothers, the other day, we are having a meeting among ourselves. He made a very, very nice point. He said, look, these Indians are there, that's why this movement has been saved. If these Indians were not there, ISKCON would have been in a very, very critical situation, very difficult situation. So it is needed. Whatever we are going through, we have to see that these are all Krishna's arrangement. Krishna is making us go through various phases. Just as when you build a building, it goes through different phases. First you dig the foundation. The building will go that way, but you are digging the other way. You are going the other way. And then it goes up. That phase is very quick, but that phase is very rough. And the more you get, the further you go into the construction, finer and finer things become. Like then you do the plastering, more fine than construct that basic structure. Then you put windows, doors, and then finally you do the interior decoration. That's even more fine. Get the lighting arrangement, get the furnitures, and so forth. So, in a way, ISKCON is going through those natural phases of development. And now one thing that, as I was saying, that in the beginning phase, like, we are so busy building up, the training aspect was not really so systematically organized. And now the numbers of devotees increasing, and many of the devotees are not living in a temple or in a close proximity, living outside. And so we are recognizing the need of training. Like, that's why, and this is one such phase. During Prabhupada's time, there was only one Bhakti Shastri course was conducted. And in that course, it wasn't done in Mayapur. And they were just given the questions and paper, and I think they had to bring the paper themselves also. And there was no sitting arrangement, they were just sitting on the floor of the veranda, and they were writing the answers there. And in that course, whoever participated got the degree. The qualification was that you took part. So everyone got the Bhakti Shastri degree. And now Bhakti Shastri courses become more systematic. Then in 1987, we actually established the Vrindavan Institute of Higher Studies, VIHE. And that was the first time, and there was a lot of participants. That I remember, I gave the Vaishnava etiquette course. And in my class alone, there were about 65 participants. Jayadita Maharaj gave a course. Burijan Prabhu gave a course. Tamakrishna Maharaj gave a course. So this is how the Vaishnava institution, where Vrindavan institution, VIHE, was started. And then Mayapur followed the same kind of pattern, and MIHE was started, Mayapur Institute of Higher Education. So this is how the move was to educate the devotees, and devotees were very keen to participate in those programs. And then after that came the phase when there were different colleges were coming up, like in Radhadesh, Belgium, this the college came up, schools started to come up, and then we started different courses like this one, the Disciple course. Because often we start to see that devotees get initiated, but they don't actually know what it means. There are lots of misconceptions actually. You know, oftentimes I find that why people are so keen to take initiation, you know what is the most attractive feature of the initiation? The guru will take all your karma. The understanding is that at the time of initiation, you dump all your karma to the guru and you become free from karmic vya. And that's why we used to find that people took initiation and after that there was no sign of them. So then we still set the standard that there has to be a proper understanding. But still we find that devotees get initiated, so they're so keen, so excited to get initiated, but that excitement doesn't last. It just fades out very quickly. They're so keen to get second initiation, but they don't have any inclination to come to the temple and do deity worship, which is one of the main purpose of second initiation. Actually, first initiation is the time one gets the Maha Mantra. Maha Mantra is the greatest of all mantras. Gayatri is mantra, but Hare Krishna is Maha Mantra. So it is Maha Mantra, the greatest of all mantras. So when you have the Maha, then do you need anything else? Not really. Then the question arises, then what's the need for second initiation? The second initiation is needed because of deity worship. Deity worship is conducted in the Bhakti Charu, to follow the rules and regulations of the scriptures. And the scriptures say, in a temple, the brahmanas only will worship the deities. Therefore, there is a need for brahmanas. Therefore, there is a system of second initiation, brahmin initiation. But they become brahmanas, but they are not interested in deity worship. Why? Because no one even taught them, no one even told them. They think that it's a process for spiritual advancement. I got first initiation, that was good, but not good enough. So now I need the second initiation. It's a kind of a status symbol also, I am a second initiated. I'm a brahmana. But in ISKCON we don't actually need brahmanas. Because the Vaishnavas are superior to the brahmanas. So when you're already in a superior platform, then what's the point in having the inferior status? So anyway, so it's all because there is no proper education. And sometimes there is pressure for Brahman initiation because there is no pujari or cook. I mean, we get so much pressure for that. You know, Maharaj, please give him second initiation. The person can't even write his own name. Can't even read. Now we have to be forced to give him Brahman initiation because the temple needs a pujari from India. I'm talking about pujaris in the West. And so we are going through different phases, and another thing is that we noticed that devotees, when they get initiation, they think that their relationship is only with the spiritual Diksha Guru, spiritual master, initiating spiritual master. And this is a very big misconception that is actually hurting ISKCON. And so they, like what actually happens, it's a very common thing, and that anybody can actually see that, that's happening. Like the temple actually makes the devotees, preaches to them, cultivates them, trains them. The temple devotees are doing that. But often we find that when one takes initiation, the loyalty shifts from the temple to the guru. And as a result of that, the temples are becoming empty. In the West especially, it's a big problem. Initiated devotees are many, but no one is there to serve the temple, no one is there to. And the devotees who cultivated them, trained them, they're completely disregarded, as if they are not important anymore, because now I've been initiated and the relationship has been established between me and my guru, and that's it. Well, if I was in my guru's ashram, then it would have been all right. But actually in ISKCON we are not functioning in our guru's ashram. In ISKCON we are functioning in Prabhupada's ashram. Previously in the Indian culture, in India, the custom was that when somebody assumed the responsibility of being a spiritual master, he used to have his own ashram. And the disciples used to stay in the ashram and get trained. And then eventually, the guru, when he used to retire, used to hand over the ashram to a successor. And other disciples who wanted to continue preaching and initiating and so forth, then they used to open their own ashrams. But that's not the case with ISKCON. Prabhupada didn't hand over ISKCON to anybody. Prabhupada retained his position as the head of ISKCON, as the founder acharya. Like Prabhupada is the founder of ISKCON, there is no doubt about that. But Prabhupada is not only the founder, Prabhupada is the acharya of ISKCON. Now this is one very, very important factor that we have to systematically consider and try to understand. Like yes, we have our gurus, but Prabhupada is the guru, the acharya. Otherwise, why should Prabhupada be so emphatic about establishing himself as the founder acharya? Prabhupada could have just been happy as a founder. But Prabhupada was very, very emphatic about that. You know, Prabhupada did not want to take any credit for anything. But I noticed that about his position as the founder acharya, Prabhupada was very particular. He gave the instruction that wherever the name ISKCON comes, it should be mentioned his name as the founder acharya. A Prabhupada who was so renounced, who never wanted to take any credit for anything, when he established ISKCON, he did not even want to establish himself. Like it was the International Society for Krishna Consciousness, not the International Society for Bhakti Vedanta Consciousness. Although those days in America, in the mid-60s, many gurus came to America. We noticed that they all were named, all their institutions were named after themselves. Mahesh Jogi, Bal Jogi, Rajneesh, Chinmayananda's mission, this mission, that mission. But the International Society for Krishna Consciousness, who is the person who established it? Hardly anybody knew those things. Prabhupada didn't want to put himself in the front. He put Krishna in the front. That is how detached Srila Prabhupada was, or that is how Krishna conscious Prabhupada was. Then why was Prabhupada so particular about the international, of him being the founder acharya of ISKCON? Later on we realized that it was for the benefit of ISKCON. It was to hold the institution together for thousands of years to come. So that's why it's very important to recognize the who is who and what is what. What is my relationship with my Diksha Guru? Now, is my Diksha Guru the only person who is going to help me in my spiritual life? Or there's a need for Shiksha Gurus? What is the role, what is the importance of the institution of ISKCON? And who is Srila Prabhupada in my life? So through the disciple course, we are trying to make everyone aware of these factors, these points. Like ISKCON is not like any other spiritual organization that there may be in India. Like, as I said, like there the relationship is just between the guru and disciple. And guru is the head. That was the case with us when Prabhupada was here. Prabhupada was the head, and all that mattered is our relationship with Srila Prabhupada. And there was a structure, and we followed the structure. The temple was there, the temple presidents were there, the GBCs were there, they were all there, but Srila Prabhupada was the head. And but now, then we embarked on a phase where we, as I just mentioned, did not really recognize the importance or the role of Shiksha Gurus. And most prominently, most predominantly, most importantly, Srila Prabhupada's role in our lives. So, to make that point, I'll just make another simple point here. The mission of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. You see, previously the consideration used to be just one's own spiritual advancement. One used to take to spiritual life. And I'm sure in India, from those who are from India, they are aware of that understanding. That when one became interested about spiritual life, so leave home, join a guru's ashram, get trained. And the purpose actually was to make spiritual advancement. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mission has some other objective. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mission had the objective of not only delivering ourselves, but to deliver others. And that is the very special mission of Sankirtan movement. The others are other spiritual benefit. So much so that one is not rather concerned about his own spiritual advancement. Like, as you know, Vasudev Dattaya, and praying to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu that let the whole world become delivered and let me go to hell, taking all the karma. And that is this mood of the devotees of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu Sankirtan movement. What will happen to me, I don't worry about. Let Krishna figure it out, what he will do with me. But let me just be concerned about how to deliver others, how to distribute this mercy of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to others. So that is why Mahaprabhu's movement is Sankirtan movement. Like, it is not just individuals' consideration, it is a collective consideration. And then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu made the prediction that this Krishna consciousness movement will spread in every town and village all over the world. And we see a very interesting development, historical development of Mahaprabhu Sankirtan movement. When Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was here, within a very short time, he inundated the whole of India with Krishna consciousness. But Mahaprabhu predicted that it will spread all over the world. They may notice one thing, that after Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's disappearance, Mahaprabhu's teaching, Mahaprabhu's movement got lost. It was completely lost, practically. And even where they were being Mahaprabhu's name and Mahaprabhu's teaching were little prevalent, they became deviant. And the deviant movement is called Prakrita Sahajiyas. Sahajiyas. They're an opasampradayas. The real expression is opasampradayas. So the deviant groups in the name of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, they were claiming that they are followers of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, but they had nothing to do with Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Just to give you an example, like some of these sampradayas, you know, their teachings is, or their process is, based on system. And that is Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur. Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur took the mission of Bhakti Vinod Thakur and spread it. And we notice also Bhakti Vinod Thakur, while spreading this movement, he also gave the maximum importance to the institution. He also did not try to establish himself, but he tried to establish the institution. But unfortunately, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur's followers could not really understand his instructions. He very emphatically gave the instruction that you manage the institution collectively. You know, Bhaktivinoda Thakur didn't mention anything about who will give initiation after him. Who will become the acharya? Who will become the spiritual leader? His instruction was very simple. Collectively, you manage the institution. But unfortunately, his followers could not understand that. His leading followers. They considered that how can a spiritual institution run by a bunch of managers? So we need an acharya. So they appointed an acharya, and when that acharya fell down, the whole structure collapsed. And then Prabhupada actually said, then everybody wanted to become the acharya. They started their own little center, one small little temple, but they gave the name Founder Acharya. And one interesting thing to note there also, we can see that in that, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur's disciples, hardly anyone actually fell down. Hardly any sannyasis fell down. Only the person who was appointed as Acharya, he fell down. But otherwise, they all carried on. Sannyasis all carried on without deviation. But the thing is, the institution disintegrated. And they were carrying on in the small little temples. They were giving initiation, they were preaching, they were educating and so forth. But that massive preaching mission that Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur started, stopped. Individually they were carrying on without any difficulty. But the preaching practically stopped. Whereas in ISKCON we notice, unfortunately though, although so many sannyasis and gurus have fallen down, preaching is expanding. Now from that we actually see the importance of an institution. There, individually everyone was carrying on, but preaching stopped. Why? Because the institution disintegrated. Whereas in ISKCON, all the individuals, Saraswati Thakur, who actually understood Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur's mission. And we can see what Prabhupada did. Exactly what Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur wanted. He said, collectively manage the institution. Prabhupada, when he came to the States, the first thing Prabhupada did is to set up the institution. Also, interesting thing to note, Prabhupada didn't really establish the institution straight away. When there was an opportunity to start preaching, Prabhupada actually wrote to his godbrothers and invited them. And Guru Maharaj wanted to preach in the West, the opportunities are coming, why don't you all come? Prabhupada was prepared to give them the leadership and function under their leadership. But when Prabhupada didn't get any favorable response from them, then Prabhupada had to start his own institution, the International Society for Krishna Consciousness. And very soon after establishing that, we see Prabhupada created the GBC, just as Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati suggested, a collective concept of management. Unfortunately, Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati could establish the GBC during his time. He simply instructed them. But Prabhupada established the GBC during his presidency. And he trained those people and gave the entire responsibility to the GBC actually for the managing of the society. And in that, Prabhupada himself became a part of the GBC. He was a part of the GBC when the vote used to take place. Prabhupada had one vote. So this is how Prabhupada was actually establishing the importance of the collective management to maintain the institution for the future. And so Prabhupada could see that to hold the institution together after his disappearance. Yeah, now maybe I can make another point here. Why the institution is so important? The institution is important because this mission of spreading Krishna consciousness all over the world is not going to happen by one person during his lifetime. Prabhupada knew that. During Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's time it happened. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the Goswamis, his followers, after the Goswamis, Narottam Das Thakur, Srinivasacharya. But they don't really see such personalities. So the point is, personalities like Srila Prabhupada comes once in a blue moon. And Prabhupada did establish the institution to continue the mission even after his disappearance. So that is why the institution is so important, and that's why we have a solemn responsibility to hold the institution together and function as a part of the institution. I was, when we brought out that book, Srila Prabhupada, the Founder Acharya, I used to go to different temples and I used to speak on that book. When I was in London, during question answer session, one very important point came up. One devotee asked me, what will happen when an extremely luminous, extremely brilliant personality comes in future? And my answer to that was, just as in Christianity we find extremely brilliant personalities like Saint Francis of Assisi, Saint Thomas of Aquinas, but they never obscured Jesus' position. They functioned as the subordinate to Jesus Christ. So brilliant personalities will come, but they all will function under Srila Prabhupada. And they'll further Srila Prabhupada's mission. They won't eclipse Srila Prabhupada. And to hold this structure together the society of devotees. Like, just consider, this movement has so many devotees. And what is holding all these devotees together in all different parts of the world? What is holding them all together? The institution of ISKCON. If the institution of ISKCON was not there, what could have happened? What would have happened? And to hold the institution together, we need two factors. One is the concept of collective management. Why the collective management? Because if anyone deviates, to deal with him, this body is necessary. Because deviations are quite prevalent, it's quite common. If someone deviates, if he is very powerful, we won't be able to deal with him individually, because he's so powerful. But if there is a body of devotees, no matter how powerful one is, when there is a body of 25 devotees, there is no one as powerful as that to deal with them. You will see, I don't want to get into that, if you look at the history of ISKCON in the recent past, there has been deviation. Certain sectors left the movement. And the whole individual was so powerful, everybody thought that, well, he will make it. But he didn't make it. Or rather, they didn't make it. Once it apparently appeared that they were flourishing. So, once a devotee asked me that, how come they're, although they have been separated from ISKCON, but they're flourishing so much. I gave the example that, when a branch is cut off from the tree, the fruits in that cut branch ripen very quickly. But that is a sign of decay. And in course of time we saw. So to hold the institution together, to prevent the society from being affected by deviation, there is a need for a collective body. And that Srila Prabhupada established as the GBC. And in order to hold the institution together, we need the head of the institution. And in ISKCON, Srila Prabhupada is that head. Just as in Christianity, Jesus has a very special position. No one will question Jesus' position. Christianity may have become divided, but they all accept Jesus Christ. The same thing with the Islam and so forth. So in a similar way, what will hold the institution of ISKCON together is Srila Prabhupada's position as the founder Acharya, and what will protect ISKCON from any kind of calamities and outside danger is the concept of the GBC. And that is why, once actually I was talking to a very prominent person. At that time he was the richest Indian. Really many of you know him also. Mr. Srichat Hinduja. Hinduja was telling me about Prabhupada's genius. He said, Prabhupada is a genius organizer. That the concept of GBC, that he is very close. He knew what happened in ISKCON, the deviation, fall down, all kinds of things he knew. And he was telling that this concept of collective management is the genius of Srila Prabhupada. And that is what is holding the institution of ISKCON together. Anyway, so this is how Srila Prabhupada has a very special position, and this is how we have to recognize that ISKCON is so important. It's because of ISKCON we are so effective and so powerful. I'll simply give one example that, being a spiritual master, I get requests for initiation from different parts of the world, candidates from different parts of the world. And I know I won't be able to train them personally myself. I rarely go there, maybe once or twice a year. But how then I dare to give initiation to those devotees, take this very solemn responsibility, because I know ISKCON is there. Their spiritual life will be protected as long as they're connected to ISKCON. Like you all can see, most of you have been initiated by gurus who are not here. But what is actually protecting your spiritual life? Your involvement with ISKCON. On the other hand, we have noticed that those who are not really properly situated and connected to ISKCON, their spiritual life is in shambles. So anyway, these are the few things that we have to recognize very, very systematically, very carefully. And please take advantage of this course. Try to understand what is your situation in relation to ISKCON. In ISKCON you have your Diksha Guru, but don't fail to see the Shiksha Gurus of ISKCON. You know who are your Shiksha Gurus? The first person who preached to you and brought you to Krishna consciousness, he is your Shiksha Guru. Although he is known as Bhatma Pradarsha Guru, the Guru who showed you the way. But he is, according to Shastra, he is your Guru. And Bhatma Pradarsha Guru, Haribhakti Vilas is saying there are three types of Gurus. First is Bhatma Pradarsha Guru. Bhatma means path. Pradarshak means indicator. And the Guru, the personality who indicated this path and brought you to the path, he is known as Bhatma Pradarsha Guru. Then Shiksha Guru, then Diksha Guru. And Haribhakti Vilas is saying that Bhatma Pradarsha Guru is also Shiksha Guru. So there are only two types of Gurus. Shiksha Gurus and Diksha Gurus. Now Diksha Guru actually gives you the mantra. But Shiksha Gurus guide you. So Diksha Guru is also a Shiksha Guru. He is not only Diksha Guru. He is a Shiksha Guru also. But there are other Shiksha Gurus as well. Whoever is helping you in your spiritual life is your Shiksha Guru. So this is actually a process of guru-disciple. Therefore, don't make that mistake to think that my Diksha Guru is the only Guru and no one else is important. No. Recognize how you are benefiting from the teachings and guidance of those who are around you. And when you read the 11th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, you will see that Uddhav Gita is talking about 24 gurus. 24 gurus. And you know who are gurus? A prostitute has been considered to be a guru. A hunter has been considered to be a guru. So this is how one sees his guru. The more you advance in your spiritual life, your concept of your guru will expand. A Kanishtha Adhikari will think that my Diksha Guru is the only guru. But when he comes to the Madhyama Adhikari platform, then he will recognize who is helping him in his spiritual life, and he will be seen as a guru. And you know what is the identity of an Uttamadhikari? Uttamadhikari will see that everybody is his guru, he is only the disciple. So this is the path we are actually training. Thank you all very much. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Please feel free to ask questions. The important part of the discussion will be this question and answer session. Yes.
Thank you for a wonderful You bring some of the devotees to the temple with great difficulty and things. And then some people here first time is gone, and they're very enthused, you know, they come here, they see, like, you know, they love everything, and they Google something and they find something bad on the internet. Like as you said, till 1986, until then we had so many issues. And after that, all like the wonderful things happened again. So if it, how to explain to them, sometimes they're not willing to listen. What to tell them actually, or like this is not the case anymore. It's in the past, but now like Prabhupada is real, books are real, the moments are flourishing. Like, how to explain exactly what can I tell them?
Very good. Very good question. Thank you.
I have something right in connection with that.
Huh?
I have one question right in conjunction with that.
Okay, yes.
So, exactly, I face the same problem. We have a Bhakti Rukshena house for the past 5 years. And they take that step, they're excited, and as he said, after they Google up, something happens. They don't want to come to the temple. And this is good. Every Friday we come here. We are with you guys, and this much is good. And you know, it's very challenging because you invest, like, you know, somebody comes to the temple one time, fine, but we invest in them 3 years, 4 years.
So okay, I got the question.
Yep.
So let me, maybe I can have the cordless, another cordless mic, so that the questioners can use that. Oh, that's the cable. Cord. So should we give them the cordless one? And I'll take that. Achieve perfection overnight? While trying to achieve perfection, do you make mistakes? So, can you hear? Or should I just continue? Yeah, it's all right. Similarly, after Prabhupada's disappearance, mistakes have been made. But does it mean that because the mistakes have been made, ISKCON is finished? Or should we consider what ISKCON is today like? What is it like today? Show me another institution that survived 38 years after the disappearance of its founder. Just look at so many spiritual organizations. What is happening to Rajneesh's institution? What is happening to... think of different institutions. After the founder or the head person leaves, what happens? It disintegrates. But did ISKCON disintegrate? What actually made ISKCON survive? And not only survive, continue to flourish against time. Rather, I'll say, against the onslaughts of time. So that is the proof. What may have happened in the past, now just consider how they have been dealt with. When somebody deviated, ISKCON dealt with, they did not allow any deviation to be tolerated. And often, you see, these kind of questions come from those who deviated themselves. And you know something? Those who left ISKCON, they will be intolerant about ISKCON's success. Because ISKCON's success is an indication of their failure. Therefore, they will always try to see that let ISKCON get destroyed. then they will be jubilant. Yes, see, I have been successful. Therefore, don't pay any heed to them. And those who are coming to you, that kind of questions, give them the right answer. And the right answer is that, fine, mistakes have been made. But had that mistake been corrected, or the mistaken condition continued? Look at ISKCON today. Like, so many individuals felt, oh, ISKCON is finished, ISKCON is gone. But the thing is then, when there is a program, Janmashtami program, Rathajatra program, you see, they come to ISKCON. Actually, that reminds me of one incident that Badri Narayan Maharaj told me that. You see, somebody was one of ex-ISKCON individual was telling, he overheard, he is talking to people saying how ISKCON is all finished. So he just told him, Maharaj, Badri was there, so Badri Narayan Maharaj was there. He said, Maharaj, look at all these people dancing and chanting. Look at the queue waiting to take prasad. Look at, and even you have come to participate, and you are saying ISKCON is finished. So that is the thing, you know, let's face the reality. Let's not dwell on what we read in Google or what a Facebook or whatever. I don't even look at them. Face the reality. Where ISKCON is today? Now show me another group that you have, you know, so boldly claiming that they are their success. I mean, see whether they have a disciple course and so many individuals sitting down to attend the course. That itself is a sign of success. Sunday feast, Ratha Jatra. What is actually enlivening all these devotees to participate in those programs? It's all ISKCON programs. Nobody else is having these programs. Does it answer your question? Does it answer your question? And I believe Madhupati Prabhu gave the class on Rituqism yesterday. So that's why I didn't get into that. Anyway, that's another story. Yes. You can sit.
Thank you for a very nice lesson. I want to know, like, for self-realization, is a Mahamantra initiation by the Guru, for self-realization, is Mahamantra initiation by Guru enough, or one should aspire for something?
Very good point. Very good point. You see, I'll answer the question with a small little example. So if you want to study, say, physics, and you decide to study in the best university in the world, Oxford. So you go to Oxford and get admission, right? But is the admission enough? Admission is the beginning. What makes you learn the subject is by systematically attending the classes, right? And listening to the lectures and sitting for the exams. So diksha is like the admission. And shiksha is attending the course. Right? So without shiksha, diksha doesn't have any meaning. Just taking initiation is not enough. You have to practically practice the process and make spiritual advancement to yourself. All right?
My question was, like, your practicing part, it included practicing part actually. My question was, like, first, second initiation, like,
now. Oh, okay. In relation to second initiation.
Yeah,
Hare Krishna Mahamantra is enough. Okay. Yeah, Hare Krishna Mahamantra. Because you got the Mahamantra. Okay, to simplify that point a little more. Gayatri Mantra can take you to Vaikuntha. But Hare Krishna Mahamantra can take you to Vrindavan. Now, where do you want to go? If you want to go to Vaikuntha, yeah, get stuck to Gayatri. But if you want to go to Vrindavan, stick to Hare Krishna.
So it's not a prerequisite.
So, and as I say, with this Hare Krishna Mahamantra, you'll go to Vrindavan, which is beyond Vaikuntha. Hare Krishna. Yes?
When you were becoming a devotee, when you join with ISKCON, you'll have some Shiksha Gurus, right? I mean, whoever joins you to the ISKCON or connects you to the ISKCON is Shiksha Guru. So let's say...
He is one of the Shiksha
Gurus. One of the Shiksha Gurus.
Yeah.
So in that process, that Shiksha Guru might be a family member or a friend or anyone. So in that case, you see at what certain level you see that that person who introduced you is okay and he's not really into, like, he's not getting into the devotional service or he's not getting into the power or something. But at that same time, we mentioned in this course that Shiksha Guru and Diksha Guru should be respected in the same way. So even though the Shiksha Guru is not really performing his duties, do we still have to respect him the way he's supposed to respect?
Yeah, well, you see, the respect should be there, but that doesn't mean that, you know, everybody will be respected in a similar way. According to one's advice, you know, ultimately respect is the internal thing, you know, where you feel, you know, your heart is automatically submitting to, that is the respect. My point here actually was that the respect should not be only for Diksha Guru and not for others. Try to recognize them. And those who are helping you in your spiritual life, they also demand and deserve your respect. And in that way, the ultimate respect actually goes to Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada is the founder Acharya. See, what is Prabhupada's role? Prabhupada is actually the ultimate Shiksha Guru. Diksha is important, but we can safely say that Shiksha is more important. Right? And Prabhupada is the most prominent Shiksha Guru for us. Right? Because all of our Shiksha is depending on Srila Prabhupada's teachings. Prabhupada's books are the basis. The gurus are giving classes. Senior devotees are giving classes on the basis of what? Srila Prabhupada's books. The senior devotees are preaching on the basis of what? Srila Prabhupada's books. So that is how important Srila Prabhupada is in the life of every single devotee of his school. And that will continue to be. It's not that only Prabhupada's disciples will worship Prabhupada. Generation after generation, all the devotees of ISKCON will worship Prabhupada. You know, that also reminds me. I mean, often we think among ourselves also, we talk about these things, you know. Like, one day I was talking to one of my godbrothers. And he made a very wonderful point. He said, Maharaj, you will be worshipped only as long as your disciples are there. But Srila Prabhupada will be worshipped by everybody, generation after generation. Because we set the standard of Guru Puja for Prabhupada every day by everybody. And that's such a valid point. You know, we may be forgotten, but Prabhupada in ISKCON will never be forgotten. Yes.
Hare Krishna Maharaj. Maharaj, you mentioned earlier in the initial part of your class today is that at the beginning of ISKCON, there are more Western devotees and now proportion has changed. And if I'm not wrong, Maharaj, group distribution in the number of temples is increasing. But what do you think is going wrong which has changed the proportion and how we can correct it?
Good point. Yeah, very good. You see, the social condition also has something to do with that. You know, in the mid-60s, I mean, Krishna actually created America. Krishna created a situation in America to receive Srila Prabhupada. Like, America in mid-60s was going through a very special phase. You know, if we look at the history of America, we can see that after the Second World War, America reached the height of material prosperity. And although America reached the height of material prosperity, then the generation after that became totally disgruntled. The youth of America in the mid-60s became totally disgruntled. You know, for various things. One thing is that they saw money cannot buy everything. They got money, they got material prosperity, but they internally they were not happy, they were not content. Then the Vietnam War was forcing them, the American youth, to join the army to fight in Vietnam for no rhyme or reason. And at that time, some professors in the West Coast, they created that synthetic drug called LSD. So, all that, you know, created a very special situation in America, and the youth of America at that time became ready to receive Srila Prabhupada. And that's why we see very quickly, you know, ISKCON movement spread. But then in the 80s, we see a change came. Now there are no more, you know, the free-thinking young boys and girls, you know, who are just trying to experiment positive alternative, right? Rather, they became very conforming with the system. They became concerned about career and things. From the hippie culture, it came the yuppie culture. Like, you know, a culture where they wanted to become, you know, successful in life, materially. So, and as a result of that, you know, the participation in ISKCON from the Western group became rather affected. And who knows, and then, you know, like, Western participation reduced, but the Indian participation increased, right? Krishna brought you all here, right? And you found something wonderful in Krishna consciousness. So now you all are joining ISKCON. So it's another phase that ISKCON is going through. And who knows what will be the next phase? It's all up to Krishna. Alright. Yes? No, give it to her.
Coming back to the original question that I had asked, do we know who's putting these websites against ISKCON out there, and then is ISKCON doing anything to take them down, or any
you see, in Kali Yuga, you can't avoid that. If you ask who is doing it, I'll say Kali is doing it. Kali has his agents. They're doing it. But Kali Doshi Nidhe Rajan Asti Hiyeko Mahan Kuna. Now the choice is yours. The possibility of degrading, possibility of deviating, is enormous. But there is one advantage. Do you want to take that advantage? That's the thing. You know, Kali Yuga, you know, allows everyone to become extremely degraded. But those who are intelligent, what they will do? They will stick to Krishna consciousness. Now the thing is, you may say, like, those who are doing, like those who are reading, your concern, is not who are writing. Your concern or our concern actually is those who are reading and how to protect them, how to protect their faith. Try to educate them, become exemplary, and those who are sincere, they will see what's what. And those who get affected by that, and in spite of hearing about that, those who do not become affected, they're the tested ones. These are Maya's tricks. You see, do you think Maya will allow Krishna consciousness to be so easily and readily available? Maya's business is to make it difficult. Maya's business is to keep the living entities, those who are not qualified, away from Krishna. So Maya will continuously test. Have you become qualified? Have you become qualified? And she will put all kinds of tests, all kinds of temptations. Come, come, enjoy with me. But the thing is, a sincere person who will not become affected by those allurements, they will pass the test. And when Maya sees that somebody is not being affected by her allurement, Maya becomes very happy. Because she is Krishna's energy. She is Krishna's maidservant. So when she sees that somebody is becoming Krishna conscious, she will say, come, I'll help you all the way to go to my brother. Like Subhadra is Maya and Krishna is Jagannath. Maya is Krishna's sister. Of course, that is Jogamaya. But then again, what's the difference between Mahamaya and Jogamaya? Same Maya, those who are averse to Krishna consciousness, for them, she is Mahamaya. Those who are favorable to Krishna consciousness, to them, she is Jogamaya. Like Prabhupada gives the example of a policeman. Same policeman, to a criminal, he is an object of fear. But to a law-abiding citizen, he is an object of shelter and safety. So make them understand that, look, this is Maya's tricks. Don't fall for that. You may say that, they may say so many people have done so many things wrong. But why don't you see so many people in ISKCON are doing the right thing? So do you want to do the right thing or wrong thing? You decide. By going away from ISKCON, will you benefit? Or by staying in ISKCON, will you benefit? You make your choice. The choice is yours. We are there to give you all the help. But ultimately, you have to decide. Do you have a question? Yeah.
I was just wondering, a small question about, we hear about how at the time of Diksha initiation, we receive the Maha Mantra from the spiritual master. And I was just wondering if you might be able to help explain that for many of us, we first came in contact with the Maha Mantra through Srila Prabhupada's teachings and how we can understand both.
Good point. Very good. You see, Hare Krishna Maha Mantra doesn't depend upon Diksha because Mahaprabhu gave it. In ISKCON also, to qualify for Diksha, you have to chant Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. So it is not that you are getting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. Actually, the Diksha has another consideration. Diksha has two considerations. Receiving the mantra and surrender. Right? So mantra has been already received. It is not that at the time of Diksha you are getting special mantra or a specially sanctified mantra. No. The consideration of the Diksha is surrender. Officially you are surrendering yourself to a representative of Krishna. So that is the main purpose of Diksha, the first initiation. Mantra you got, yes, as you say from Prabhupada's books, you got the mantra. Actually, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gave the mantra. The devotee who spoke to you and gave the mala, he gave you the mantra, right? Asked you to chant the holy name. So, the mantra has been already available. But it's the important factor for initiation is surrender. Thank you. So, any other question? Yes?
Yeah, I can help you. So, Maharaj, is there any book on Lord Sri Ram's pastime written by Srila Prabhupada?
Lord
Sri Ram's.
Sri Ram's?
Yeah.
In Srimad Bhagavatam, in the ninth canto, there is Lord Ramchandra's pastime.
But there's no special.
No special. Prabhupada did not write anything specially.
So the question is like, when somebody is in ISKCON giving a lecture on Sri Ram, which book they should refer actually? Is it Valmiki's Ramayana or Kalidas Ramayana?
Prabhupada wanted us to stick to Valmiki Ramayana. Right? Because that is the authentic Ramayana. Or rather, most authentic Ramayana. Thank you. Any other question? Yes, Sudhakar?
Sometimes...
Okay, you don't need a mic.
Sometimes devotees give a class on Srimad Bhagavatam, for example, and then ask the question, how many people are reading the books? And hardly any hands go up. And I just wanted to bring it up.
Yeah. Are you reading? Okay, to keep trying and ask others also to try. I can understand, you know, like, I mean, I can understand how busy you all are. Like, you know, I mean, I know, like, you have to drive 3 hours back and forth every day and then work for so many hours. I mean, it's tough, it's difficult. And it's praiseworthy that in spite of your busy, so busy schedule, that you all are practicing, you all are chanting the holy name, prescribed numbers and so forth. That itself is admirable. Right? But keep trying. No? The ideal situation would be that you don't have to work like that. You have all the time to yourself to render service to Krishna and cultivate your Krishna consciousness. So try to have the best out of a bad bargain. That's what I'm. Yes? Thank you.
How
I came to Krishna consciousness.
How was it with Prabhupada, you know, when you met him?
I was
just curious, you know, I just
want
to know.
Okay. No, it's nothing to be sorry about it. You know, I came in contact with ISKCON in 1970 in Germany. And I used to visit the temple in Hamburg. They had a small little kind of a ashram. But then I stopped going there. I don't want to go to the details why I stopped going there. And then at one point I decided to take to spiritual life. And I went back to India. And I was searching for a guru because I knew to progress in spiritual life you need a guru. And I got completely disappointed that I couldn't find him. And I used to go by ISKCON temple, which was in Calcutta. ISKCON temple was not too far from my house, but I never thought of going there because ISKCON was not at all in my agenda at that time. But then I got a nectar of devotion. And as I started to read it, from the very first page, I felt that this is what I was looking for. And then the next night, I had a dream of Srila Prabhupada. It was a very, very beautiful dream. I still can, you know, vividly perceive it in my mind. Like, I saw Prabhupada sitting on a throne. Those days I didn't know what a vasasana was. Because the sadhus in India generally don't sit on elaborate seats. They sit on a simple asana, sometimes a tiger skin or something, you know, deer skin. But Prabhupada was sitting something on something that looked like a throne. And there was a brilliant light coming out of Srila Prabhupada's body. I mean, as if there's a beautiful, brilliant light around him. And just the sight was enough. And I felt that I finally found my spiritual master. So that, and then, you know, at that time Prabhupada was in America. So I thought of, you know, visiting different places of Mahaprabhu's pastimes and Krishna's pastimes. And then I thought that when Prabhupada came to India, then I would surrender to him. And thinking that the first place I went was to Mayapur. I arrived there in the evening, and the next morning I shaved up, threw away my old clothes, and put on dhoti kurta. And that's how it all started. And then I was also very fortunate that when I first met Srila Prabhupada, Prabhupada gave me the service to translate his books into Bengali. And that actually allowed me to stay close to Srila Prabhupada. Those days, mind you, Prabhupada had about 10,000 disciples, 10,000 followers. Initiated disciples were 6,000. But 10,000 followers, and to have, I mean, devotees used to fly from America, Australia, Europe, just to have a few minutes association of Srila Prabhupada. So at that time I was fortunate enough to be with Srila Prabhupada practically 24 hours a day. So that's how it all started. Okay, any other question? Yes.
Hare Krishna, Maharaj.
Hare Krishna.
Maharaj, one of the services I got from temple president, other senior devotees, along with other devotees, to raise some fund for the temple. And I met one, like a television gentleman, very prominent position of the temples. I asked him, is there any way, like, you know, I can help, because he wanted a lot of money for Balaji temple and things. He asked one of the questions that you claim yourself International Society of Krishna Conscious, you have branches all over the world. I know personally some of the temples are really, really flourishing there. Don't you get any funds from there or something like that? And also my job has been, like, the past 7-8 years I've been traveling to a lot of temples, a lot of states and work and things. So I see a lot of temples, they've been really, really struggling and things like that. So I want to understand, is it everything is decentralized or something, the temple, things like that?
Yeah, Prabhupada didn't want to centralize. Sometimes there was an effort to centralize. You see, one of our godbrothers, like, he was Iranian. His name was Atreya Rishi. He was from Harvard, Harvard Business Management. And he was the head of one of the big farms, I forgot. Oh, Ernst & Young. And so, but he joined ISKCON. So he, with his business management acumen, you know, tried to centralize things. And he was in Los Angeles, and so the devotees were also very inspired, you know. Like, but when Prabhupada got to know that, Prabhupada just stopped it. Prabhupada said no. And the way Prabhupada structured it, every temple is a unit. The world is divided by different zones. But in the zones, every temple actually is an unit, independent, and managed by the temple president. Prabhupada didn't even want the GBCs to interfere into the management of the temple. Prabhupada wanted the GBCs to maintain the spiritual standard, to go and see the temple activities and see whatever they help they need and guide them in the spiritual progress. But the temple was managed, Prabhupada wanted them managed by the temple president. So that's the structure Srila Prabhupada gave. This is also another genius of Srila Prabhupada. Like, you know, every temple is a unit and they have the responsibility to, you know, the temple president has all the responsibility to develop the temple. And it's his headache, right? Where the money will come from and how the money will be properly utilized. GBCs will help. As a GBC, I used to see two things in my temple. That the temples need two things actually from the GBC. Man and money. And I felt that is the responsibility that I have, you know, to provide whatever they need, especially in the form of manpower and money. Okay, so thank you all very much. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Gaur Premanande Hariyo. Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Niti Namine. Namaste Saraswati Devi Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatta Dushita. Bhakti Vedanta Swami Niti Namine Namaste Sharishvati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatta Nishtha Srila Prabhupada ki. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
So, at a time like this, I just wonder, what should I speak about? So one topic I noticed that everybody likes to hear is about Srila Prabhupada. How many of you want to hear about Srila Prabhupada? Okay. Srila Prabhupada is our founder acharya. Srila Prabhupada came to give us Krishna. How many of you knew about Krishna before you came across ISKCON? Okay, you knew about Krishna, but if I ask you to what extent you knew Krishna? Practically in India, everybody knows about Krishna. But to what extent? I'll give you an example. The extent that Indians know about Krishna. You know something? That in India, for everything they give a holiday. But in India, Janmashtami is not a holiday. Doesn't it say it all? Janmashtami, which is the most important spiritual occasion, government doesn't give. Even though it's supposed to be what is called Hindutva government, trying to establish Hindutva. Even that government doesn't announce Janmashtami as a holiday. So that goes back to the point, what is Hindutva? You know what is Hindutva? Hindutva means hodgepodge. I say Hindus, who are the Hindus? You know what's the definition of Hindus? Those who don't have any religious conviction, they are Hindus. Muslims have their religion, Christians have their religion, Jews have their religion. But Hindus? Why? Because there is no proper education. All kinds of misconceptions are flying in the name of Hinduism. Srila Prabhupada came and gave us the clear understanding what real Vedic culture is. Let me ask this way. How many of you have found the real Vedic culture after coming in contact with this God? Only so few. How many of you are following Vedic culture? Please raise your hand. Do you understand what I'm asking? How many of you are following ISKCON's teaching? Then what are you following? Then? Why so few hands are going up? When you ask how many of you are following the Vedic culture? Let's see, how many of you are following Vedic culture? It's a little better. Okay, now let us see what Srila Prabhupada gave us. Beforehand, did we know the difference between the Supreme Personality of Godhead and the demigods? Like how many of you are from Maharashtra? And what was your worshipable Lord? Ganapati. And it goes like that. How many of you are from Bengal? What was your worshipable Supreme Lord? And it goes, how many of you are from Uttar Pradesh? Who is your worshipable Lord? Lord Shiva. How many of you are from Tamil Nadu? Who is your worshipable Lord? Well, some of them are worshipping Narayan, but most of them are Murugan worshippers. So this is the state of affairs of Hinduism in India. And that is why people think that Hinduism is a polytheistic religion. Polytheistic religion means a religion that believes in many gods. But is Hinduism actually a polytheistic religion or monotheistic religion?
Krishna.
So is there some difference? Where did you get this understanding? I can see the children respond better than you. They got it right. So, this is what Srila Prabhupada gave us. Are you grateful to Srila Prabhupada for that?
Yes.
Srila Prabhupada gave us the right understanding. Krishnastu Bhagavan Swayam. Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. I'll just go briefly to the history, why it is like that. You know why it has become like that, why Hinduism became so confused? Hinduism became so confused because of the age of Kali. In the age of Kali, as the Kali Yuga began, the Brahmanas started to kill animals in the name of sacrifice. Nindasi Jagga Vide Rahaha Shruti Jatam. Shruti Jatam. Based on the Vedas, Shruti, they started to Sadaya Ridaya Darshita Pashu Ghatam. Pashughatam, innumerable animals are being slaughtered. And seeing that unnecessary animal slaughter, the Lord Sadaya Hridaya, his soft heart, his tender heart, became afflicted. Therefore, in order to stop animal sacrifice, the Lord came, Keshava Dhrita, Buddha Sharira. Lord appeared as Buddha. And in order to stop the animal sacrifice that was going on in the name of Vedas, what did Buddha do? Rejected the Vedas. No need to follow the Vedas. So the animal sacrifice was going on in the name of the Vedas. Therefore, by rejecting the Vedas, he stopped the animal sacrifice and started and established a new concept of religion, Buddhism. Non-violence, and just be good. So there are 10 principles of being good, and he said the ultimate goal of life is Nirvana. This material nature is a place of suffering, so become free from that suffering condition by becoming, by achieving Nirvana, meaning become nothing. So, Lord Buddha achieved that goal. Stopped animal sacrifice. But the whole of India became Buddhist. They rejected the Vedas. No more contact with the Vedas. But in order to re-establish the Vedas, the Lord asked Lord Shiva. Now, establish the Vedas. I have made arrangements to reject the Vedas. Now you establish the Vedas. Therefore, Shankaracharya, Lord Shiva came as Shankaracharya. And what did Shankaracharya do? So Buddhists have rejected the Vedas and they say there is no need to follow the Vedas. So he had the task now to re-establish the Vedas. So what did Shankaracharya do? Shankaracharya established a new theory called Mayavad. Mayavadam Asat Shastram Prachanna Bodham Uchyate. Vishnu Puran is saying that. Mayaiva Vihitam Devi Kalau Brahmana Murtina. In the age of Kali, appearing as a Brahmana, Brahmana Murtina, I will, Mayaiva, by me, will be established a temporary religion, Asat Shastram, in order to re-establish the Vedas. So Lord Shiva came as Shankaracharya. Now, you see, Buddhist concept is, the ultimate goal of life is Nirvana. Nirvana means to become nothing. Therefore, Buddhism is called Shunyavad, or voidism, void. Void means nothing. The goal of life is to become nothing. So Shankaracharya raised that point, that he was saying Nirvana means to become nothing. But actually this Nirvana is a Vedic concept. According to the Vedas, Nirvana means to merge into Brahma. And Brahma is everything. Everything has manifested from Brahma. So to merge in Brahma is Nirvana. And this is how Shankaracharya re-established the Vedas. By defeating Buddhism with their own concept. In this respect, this is like, an example is given. Just as with a thorn, you pick a thorn. When you get a thorn sticking on your feet, then what do? With another thorn you pick that. So Shankaracharya did that. With a thorn, he picked a thorn. The Vedas have been established, but the full concept of the Vedas haven't been given. Just a partial concept of the Vedas has been given in order to establish. Now Shankaracharya's theory, Mayavad. Mayavad. Mayavad literally means the theory of illusion. Maya. So Shankaracharya establishing that Maya, what is Maya? Maya is illusion, this creation is illusion. Therefore, it is false. But the real reality is Brahma. Brahma Satya, Maya Jagat Mitha. This Jagat is false, the reality is Brahma. And Brahma is Nirakar, doesn't have any form, Nirvishesh and so forth. See, nothing and something. Like, something is better than nothing. So he is establishing that something, but not the full thing. The full thing is, the problem is, if Shankaracharya tried to establish the Vedas to the full extent, the form of the Lord and his incarnations and so forth, then the Buddhists won't accept that. They say, well, that is your concept, we don't. But Shankaracharya pointed out that what you're calling to be sunya, but actually it is not sunya, it is purna, and purna is nothing. In the sense, when you say that Brahma doesn't have any form, doesn't have any quality, doesn't have any variety, doesn't have any potency, doesn't have anything, then what does Brahma mean? Brahma also in this way means nothing. And he gave an analogy to establish that theory. That analogy was, just as you make a mistake, seeing a mirage, you mistake it to be water. Just as seeing a rope, you mistake that to be a snake. Similarly, this is mistake. The jagat is a mistake, false, mitha. Is there water in a mirage? No. Is there a snake in the rope? No, but it appears to be. So this is the analogy he gave to establish his theory of Maya, which is actually called Kevala-dvaitavad. Another name for that is Vivartavad. Vivartavad. Vivarta means theory of illusion. The Vedic concept is Parinambad. Brahma is fine. Brahma is accepted according to the Veda. But this Jagat is a transformation of Brahma. Brahma Parinambad. Brahman has transformed into this Jagat. But Shankaracharya is saying that this jagat is a mistaken concept of Brahma, the illusory concept of that Brahma. Actually, Brahma doesn't have any form. Brahma doesn't have any quality. Brahma doesn't have any variety. So if something doesn't, say if Brahma doesn't have quality, Brahma doesn't have any form, Brahma doesn't have any variety, then what is Brahma? Indirectly, it is saying that Brahma is also nothing. So in order to defeat the Buddhists, he actually came up with this temporary conclusion. Asat Shastam. Asat means non-partner. Shastra. But he fulfilled his objective. He established the Vedas. Vedas have been now re-established. But then came Ramanujacharya. And Ramanujacharya over Shankaracharya's Kevala-dvaitavad established Vishishta-dvaitavad, a specific non-dualism. Shankaracharya's theory is absolute non-dualism, Keval-advaitavad, and Ramanujacharya established Vishishta-advaitavad, specific non-dualism. And how did he defeat Shankaracharya's theory of Kevala-dvaitavad? He said that fine, there is no water in the mirage. But somewhere the water is existing, that's why you're mistaking the mirage to be water. If there was no water, then there was a question of mistaking to be water. Somewhere the snake is existing, that's why you're mistaking the rope to be a snake. Therefore, the spiritual variety, spiritual reality is not devoid of variety. It is of spiritual variety, and this is a mistaken concept. We are mistaking this spiritual variety to be the variety of this material nature. So anyway, this is how Ramanujacharya re-established. Now, actually, Shankaracharya, in order to establish his theory, he made that point, all the forms are imaginary. The forms are imaginary. This is actually, all the forms and varieties are due to the influence of the modes of material nature. Brahman is the reality, absolute reality. Brahman in the mode of goodness is incarnation. Brahman in mode of passion is jivas. Right? Therefore, if the jivas transcend the mode of passion and come to the mode of goodness, then the jivas become God, Narayana. That's why they address the sannyasis who are supposed to be in the mode of goodness as Narayana. Namo Narayana. When they see each other, they address each other as Narayana. Because they have now come to the mode of goodness. But beyond goodness is when the Brahman is without the effect of the modes of nature, then it is pure Brahman. That Brahman is just a light and without any form and quality, etc. So therefore, the understanding is that all the forms are necessary, are needed at some point for meditation. But when you realize Brahman, then the forms will disappear. Right? So they talk about five different forms. Narayan, Shiva, Durga, Surya and Ganesh. So these forms are meditated upon. Therefore, that's how the understanding is. Any form you worship is alright, ultimately it will become formless. Therefore, the forms are temporary, forms are not important. And that is why this concept of multi-gods. And ultimately, as I say, when you come to mode of goodness, then you become God. Isn't that understanding prevailing mostly in India? There were so many gods and goddesses. Samukh Bhagavan, such and such Bhagavan, such and such Bhagavati, such and such Devi, and so forth. So that is the misconception that is prevailing. But why did Srila Prabhupada come? What is Prabhupada's pranam mantra? How many of you remember that? Yes, what is the second stanza of Prabhupada's pranam mantra? Namaste. Very good. Nirvishesha Shunnavadi Paschattarishtani. What is the Nirvishesha? Nirvishesha means Shankaracharya's Mayavada. And Shunnavad means Buddhism. Shunnavad. So Prabhupada came to defeat this misconception of Mayavad and Shunnavad. How did Prabhupada do that? By giving us Krishna consciousness. And what is the understanding? All the understandings are there in the Vedas. Brahmeti, Paramatmeti, Bhagavaniti Sabdati, Badanti Tattatta Vidas Tattvam, Jajjnanam Advayam, Brahmeti, Paramatmeti, Bhagavan. Those who know the absolute truth, Tattva Vidam, Tattvam, Jajjnanam Advayam, the knowledge which is non-dual. They identify that one absolute truth as Brahma, Paramatma and Bhagavan. When one is trying to see the absolute truth through knowledge, jnana, then he sees Brahma. When one approaches that absolute truth through yoga, he sees that absolute truth as Paramatma, super soul in the heart. And when one approaches that absolute truth through bhakti, then he sees him as Bhagavan. So Bhagavan is the ultimate identity of the Lord. Paramatma is his localized aspect and Brahma is his bodily effulgence. His bodily effulgence is Brahma, Brahma Jyoti. The Lord is not Brahma, Lord is Param Brahma, as Arjun said in Bhagavad Gita. Param Brahma, Param Dhamma, Pavitram, Paramam Bhavan. You are the Param Brahma, you are the Supreme Shelter. Param Dhamma, Pavitram, you are the absolute pure, absolute auspiciousness. So that is the simple, very simple understanding Prabhupada gave. And by receiving that knowledge, did you benefit? Did you benefit? Did the misconception has been cleared? Or do you still have that misconception? The forms are imaginary. No, all these forms are real. Ganesh is there. Surya is there. Durga is there. Shiva is there in their respective places. Who is Shiva? Shambhu? Brahma Samhita is describing. Who is Lord Shiva? Kshiram Jatha Dadi Vikara Vishesha Yoga. Just as by the touch of acid, milk becomes dadhi or yogurt. Similarly, the Lord has transformed Himself into Sambhutamopi, became Sambhu or Lord Shiva, in order to perform some specific karjam upaiti. So the Lord Himself has transformed. Krishna or Vishnu has become Shambhu. Who is, this way you can see, who is Ganesh? He is there. Ganesh is a personality. He's not an imaginary character. He is a personality. What he is doing? Jat pada pallava jugam vinidhaya kumbha Gande pranama samaye sa ganadhi raja. Ganadhi raja. Who is ganadhi raja? Who is ganapati? Ganesh. Gana isha. Holding the lotus feet of the Lord on his head. Jagat trayasya of three worlds. Bignan bihantum. Destroying all the bigna. Bigna means impediments, obstacles. He is removing the obstacle, holding the lotus feet of the Lord on his head. Who is Lord then Surya? Who is Surya? Raja Samasta Suramurti Rashesha Keta. He is the Lord of all the planetary systems. Jassa Gaya, he is traveling. Jassa Gaya Brahmati Samprita Kalu Chakra. So this is how all the understandings are becoming clear. Who are the incarnations? Ramadi Murti Shukala Niyamena Tishtham Nana Avatara Makorod Bhuvaneshu Kintu Krishna Swayam Samabhavat Parama Kumati. All the incarnations are his parts and parcels, his expansion. So did you get the understanding now clearly? Who is Durga? Maya hi jastra jagadanda satani sute traigunna tatvishaya veda vidayamana. Maya who is producing jagadanda satani sute. Innumerable jagadandas are universal. He is external energy. So this is how now we got the perfect understanding. So what are you going to do about it now? Utilize it, practice it, and commit yourself to that? Right. That is the goal of life. And that's what Srila Prabhupada came to give us. So express your gratitude by accepting the path that Srila Prabhupada has given us and follow this path with all sincerity. Thank you all very much. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Does anybody have any question? Yes?
Thank you for being in the room. All these people are living, founded people for sir. But they also know, everyone knows Veda Sanskrit. But why their paths are different?
I explained it. To achieve certain objective, but Lord came as Buddha to stop the animal sacrifice. Shankaracharya came to re-establish the Veda. The paths are not different. They are presenting in a certain way to achieve certain object. Right? Achieve certain object. So try to get the whole picture. That's what Prabhupada gave. If you look at it partially, yes, they are different paths. But if you get the total picture, then you get the full understanding. A building is going to go up. The first you do, what do you do? Do you start building up or you start digging down? Then goes it this way, that way, and so forth. Now if somebody says, well, he's not building the house, he is just digging the ground. If you look at the digging the ground, then you'll get a different picture. But when you see the complete house, then you can see. That is the foundation, that is the wall, and that is the slab of the floor. Yes. Take a mic here. Anyway, say it, don't worry. Why did Krishna just create one person? Yeah, because if he, one person means what? Krishna sent one person, that's Prabhupada. Right? And that one person gave us a complete understanding. Alright? So you don't have to go through different other persons. Alright? Because if you try to go through other persons, they'll end up becoming confused. Right? Do you want to become confused? No? So, you want to be perfectly in knowledge. Right? Who gave you the knowledge? Did Prabhupada give you the perfect knowledge? Right? Okay. Yes? Yes, what did you understand? Tell me.
I understood that I didn't understand. The question is that why did the different people they're trying to.
Okay, it's like Lord Buddha came. Why? What did he do? Did I tell you? Remember what I told? What? Okay, and how did you stop animal sacrifice? Very good. By ignoring the Vedas. Now the Vedas have been rejected. Now without Vedas can you understand God? Okay, so do you want to understand God? So do you need Vedas? Right? So Vedas were rejected, now the Vedas have to be re-established. Right? So now the Buddhists have rejected the Vedas. Now you have to make the Buddhists accept the Vedas. What do you do? Yes, but if you just tell them that you are wrong, then they'll say, okay, that's what you think. Exactly. By showing how they are wrong. The Buddhists say Nirvana is the goal of life. And the Buddhist concept of Nirvana is? Tell me, what is the Buddhist concept of Nirvana? To become nothing. Right? And Shankaracharya came and said, no, Nirvana doesn't mean to become nothing. Nirvana means to become one with Brahma. Right? And this is how he proved them wrong, and this is how he forced them to accept the Lord. Or yes, you know, like this is how he converted the Buddhists back to the Buddhists. Yes, and Prabhupada came and gave that. Not only India, but the whole world. How many religions are you following now? Which one? Very good. So either, now, will everybody in the whole world, if they follow this religion, will they benefit? Will they get the right understanding of religion? Now when you get this correct understanding, then you see the difference between Christianity and Islam and Hinduism and so forth. Like, you know what Prabhupada said? When some Christian Catholic priest in New York told Prabhupada, why are you converting the Christian boys and girls into Hindus? You know what Prabhupada told them? No, I'm not converting the Christians into Hindus or Muslims into Jews. I'm making better Christians out of Christians. Better Jews out of Jews. Better Hindus out of Hindus. And better Muslims out of Muslims. Say for example, you are a Hindu. Now you have become a better Hindu. Isn't it? You have become a real Hindu.
I know.
So there are some devotees who are coming from Christian background. Did they become real Christians? Real Jews? Isn't it? There are so many Christians in our movement. Is there any Christian here? Huh? So they became real Christian. Didn't you become a real Christian? Meaning, didn't you now understood the real teachings of Jesus Christ? Okay, does it answer your question? Thank you very much. Okay, what's your question? Yes, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu actually gave the real essence of the Vedas, and that is what Srila Prabhupada is doing. Right? What Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gave, Prabhupada is distributing. Yes, what's your question? You took the mic? Do you have a question? Oh, he passed it on. Okay. Well, yes, Sudhakar.
What is the difference between Madhvacharya's
Dvaitavada and
our
philosophy? Yeah. You see, there is difference in the sense what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gave is the perfect understanding. Right? Like for example, over Kevala Dvaitavada of Shankaracharya, Ramanujacharya established Vishishta Dvaitavada. Right? Then Madhvacharya established Dvaitavada. Now still there was conflict between the Shankarites and the Vaishnavas. Right? But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came and harmonized everything through his achinta bhed avbhed. Not just complete bhed or not complete avbhed. But there is simultaneously both bhed and avbhed. Similarity and difference. But that similarity and difference is spiritual, therefore it is beyond our conception. Therefore it is achinta. And achinta means beyond our mental conception. Therefore we have to accept it the way it has been presented in the scripture. In that respect, Prabhupada gives an example. On the field of atheism or Buddhism, Shankaracharya laid the foundation. Right? On that foundation, Ramanujacharya, Madhvacharya, Nimbarkacharya and Vishnu Swami, these four Sampradaya Acharyas, built the temple. And Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu established the deity of Radha Krishna in the temple. Isn't that the perfect, complete understanding? That's what Chaitanya. Okay, thank you all very much. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. We'll end the class with a little kirtan. Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama, Krishna, Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama, Hare
Hare. Yeah.